of weaving and the abundant harvest of designs, techniques, meanings.
Nak pergi mian anu pinik pinik sedih sedih isap mian mesahinin sedih mian sedih sedih ien.
Hello, kuma ba sa rumba minawam. Kamu ma mabawali ya kulam na minawam.
Dayaw, our knowledge, our pride.
Be right,
don't
be first.
Just throw away questions.
In that order. That's how we break the news. We don't just narrate events as they unfold. We gather insights from all sides to help you see through the spin. That is ANC's Rundown, Monday to Friday at 10 a.m. and 2 p.m. and Saturday at 8 a.m. here on ANC.
Magandang gabi, bayan.
Stay updated with the daily issues and current events.
Tulad po ng aming pinangako, nagbabalik ang ating TV Patrol.
With the Philippines' leading local evening newscast. The national stories presented to you by the country's trusted anchors and reporters. TV Patrol. Watch it weeknights here on the ABS-CBN News Channel. This is the Philippines.
Buhay.
We are ANC.
Hello everyone, I'm Michelle Long. It's 9 a.m. in Manila, 10 a.m. in Tokyo, and 12 noon in Sydney. The headlines? Wall Street suffers its worst day in weeks, with the Nasdaq posting its largest daily percentage fall in 4 months. Tech stocks under pressure amid rising bond yields. Here in Asia, markets are poised to mirror those losses. Here at home, the PSE Index resumes trading following yesterday's holiday break. We're kicking off at the 6,700 level, the number to beat to snap a two-week losing streak, 6,926. Are we in for a last-minute bounce? Ron Nakoba of Trading Edge joins us for Market Outlook. COVID-19 cases in the Philippines hit 568,000. Worldwide confirmed infections near 113 million. And we take a closer look at the MICE industry as the Philippines further eases restrictions on gatherings, with Agnes Pasis, the Vice President and General Manager of SMX Convention Centers. With the financial markets, a bloodbath on Wall Street as tech stocks remain under pressure following a rise in U.S. bond yields. The tech-heavy Nasdaq dropping 3.5%, its worst slide since October. The S&P 500 also falling 2.5%, while the Dow shed 1.8%, or 560 points. Tesla was one of the worst performing stocks, losing 8%. Apple, Amazon, Alphabet, and Facebook each falling more than 3% overnight. Now, this drop came as yields on the 10-year Treasury note jumped to as high as 1.56% from Wednesday's 1.38. And at this level, the yield is already comparable to stock dividend yields. And the fact that Treasuries carry no capital risk could trigger an exodus from risky stocks into bonds. Now, this also reflects inflation concerns and worries that an eventual rebound in the U.S. economy may prompt the Federal Reserve to cut back its support to the financial system. Fed officials, though, have dismissed such fears. Still, investors continue to rotate into areas seen benefiting from an economic rebound like energy, industrials, and financials.
I mean, I look back at where the 10-year was prior to the November 8th release of, yes, we are going to accelerate the COVID vaccinations. And we have moved almost 100 basis points since that time. You know, I am a little bit weary. On one hand, yes, This increasing yield would signal that there is strength in the economy. There is still, if you look at the jobless claims again today, there is still a third of the population that is not being talked about. And those are the ones suffering during these times, the ones that probably aren't participating in this massive run-up in the market.
Speaking of the labor market, fewer Americans filed new unemployment claims last week. Initial claims totaled to 730,000 compared to 841,000 the week before. But the near-term outlook remains unclear after winter storms wreaked havoc in southern U.S. last week.
Well, the fact of the matter remains is that even though the recovery has been showing solid progress since the depths of the current recession, we're still several million jobs in the hole. It's going to take us a long time to get back to the levels that we had even seen before the crisis began. COVID is determining the trajectory of the recovery right now. So we really need to get the public health situation under control before we can hope for a full economic recovery.
Taking a look now at U.S. stock futures, all of them still feeling the pressure and may open lower when they do so tonight, Manila time. Despite the broad market slide, GameStop shares surged again, leading a surprise resurgence of so-called stonks or meme stocks. Shares of the video game retailer closed 18.6% higher at $108 after doubling in the previous session. Earlier in the session, it was also up about 90%. Now, other meme stocks like headphone maker Cause and AMC Entertainment have also jumped this week. The rally is very similar to last month's, which was fueled by retail investors on social media. Analysts, though, are still searching for a possible fundamental catalyst in the frenzy.
Well, there's clearly a herd mentality going on where people on social media are saying good things about the stock and rushing in and seeing the increase, and there's momentum, and retail investors are fueling that momentum. I think to some extent that's a symptom of a broader issue. I think if there's an issue that needs to be regulated, it's the payment for order flow system that has given rise to this sort of no commission trading that is in the marketplace. I would prefer the SEC do the regulation as opposed to Congress, because you know they're expert in this. You know.
Coinbase, the biggest U.S. cryptocurrency exchange, moves a step closer to listing on the NASDAQ. It disclosed its regulatory filing to go public on Thursday. If approved by the U.S. Securities and Exchange Commission, it would pave the way for the highest profile share listing of a company which focuses on cryptocurrencies. Last year, Coinbase pulled in a total of $1.3 billion in revenue. That's up from $533 million in 2019, thanks to Bitcoin's unprecedented rise. Over here in Asia, stocks opened sharply lower following that bloodbath on Wall Street overnight as rising bond yields rattled equities investors. Japan's Nikkei 225, as you can see, leading losers down 3% in early trade. Markets in South Korea and Australia also in the red, firmly in the red at that. Meanwhile, Tencent-backed WeDoctor's valuation reaching nearly $7 billion ahead of its initial public offering in Hong Kong. WeDoctor is a telemedicine unicorn company that offers online appointment bookings and diagnosis. It plans to go public in Hong Kong as early as next month. Now here are some economic data releases we're monitoring today. Friday, Thailand will announce January jobs data. Now unemployment in Thailand dropped to 1.5% in December of last year from 2% the previous month as an easing of COVID-19 curbs led to a revival in economic activity. Meanwhile, Malaysia, Mexico, and Turkey will all be coming out with trade numbers for January. And India will release fourth quarter and full year 2020 growth figures. Now, India's economy, the biggest in Asia after China, plunged 7.5% in the third quarter of last year, which is slower than the record 23.9% decline during the previous quarter in the immediate aftermath of the pandemic. But the two successive quarters of contraction mean India has entered into a technical recession for the first time in its history. Essential meetings and social events will now be allowed in hotels, restaurants, and other accredited meetings venues, even in areas under general community quarantine. The Tourism and Trade Departments recently signed a joint memorandum allowing standalone venues to hold such events at 50% capacity for up to 8 hours. Will this finally restart the country's MICE industry? Joining us this morning is Agnes Pasis, the Vice President and General Manager of one of the biggest convention center companies here in the Philippines under the SM Group. We have SMX Convention Centers. Hi, good morning.
Good morning, Michelle. How are you?
Good. So, Agnes, it's great to have you on the show. So I guess I want to start with what's happening around the world. I mean, China was already holding an international import expo as early as November last year in Shanghai. Around the same time, Singapore had its travel trade show. And even earlier than that, Dubai World Trade Center already restarted their MICE with an August AI conference. Here in the Philippines, how soon, realistically, do you think can we restart MICE?
Yeah, very good question. It's a million-dollar question. we are envious of our neighboring countries, the region at least, have started their MICE, even if it's still hybrid, as we call it, like a blended offline and online event. Here in the Philippines, we feel that we need to take baby steps into that, and we want to make sure that we don't compromise health and safety of all people involved, stakeholders and the participants of a gathering. So the vaccination and the rollout to the population is very, very critical in making sure that we get there as safe as we could be. So I'm saying maybe in a few more months down the road, within the year, we're getting more and more inquiries now for hybrid and even physical face-to-face events later on this year.
I guess that's what I want to ask you. Long term, do you think that, you know, people will still prefer the good old-fashioned face-to-face physical fairs versus online virtual tours, virtual expos? You know, I attended last year the Canton Fair, which was done all online, and it was a nightmare having to scroll through thousands of pages to see products. I know that there is a printing fair in Europe, it's Drupa, reportedly planning to do the fair this year virtually using VR, so the attendees will need VR goggles. Do you think we're also up for this high-tech pivot, or that Filipinos will stick to, as I mentioned, the good old-fashioned physical fairs?
Well, Filipinos are more social animals, so to speak. We're very tactile people, we're very social, and I think that will never go away. Similar to travel agents, the traditional travel agents are still around despite having online travel agents come through over the last few years. So I think there will still be online events, and depending on the industry and depending on the product, though there are products though that need more, you know, you need to stimulate the senses, you need to touch, you need to smell, and you need to be able to see it physically. So that will never go away. And we'd like to think that that will happen sooner than later as well here in the Philippines.
So speaking of the physical space, I know that you guys are looking at reimagining and repurposing your spaces. Help us imagine what are the new use cases that you have? I know you have 6 SMX convention centers across the country. That's a lot of space we're talking about.
And going on 7, because we're opening Clark very soon too.
Is it this year, Clark?
This year, in a few more months. Okay. So that's our second standalone venue next to our SMX in Mua. But I think, yes, there will be opportunities to reimagine or repurpose the spaces. And we have been doing that over the past few months, some of which are swing spaces. Those are spaces we provide companies so they could have an extension of their offices because they found out that their workspaces are no longer enough for the density that's required by the Department of Health. Mm-hmm. We also have what we call SMX Soul Kitchen. We know that there are a lot of people who've gone into cooking and providing food over the lockdown. So we provide what you call a satellite kitchen when the person or the entrepreneur finds out her kitchen at home is no longer enough. Mm-hmm. We also have SMX exams. That has gained a lot of traction because what it is we provide space for examinees of licensure, board exams, and there's enough space between examinees for them to be able to focus. We also have, we call the SMX hybrid events. Mm-hmm. That's providing a platform for offline and online events. We also have what we call the SMX bazaars. When we are able to provide the shopaholics of this world, the passionate fashionistas, a space for it. And then we have SMX Fitness. You guessed it right. It's for the fitness enthusiast to have a lot of room where they could actually burn some calories. Yeah, more in the pipeline. But those are some of the concepts that have been in place already, of course, observing all the protocols and safety guidelines.
So let me get this straight, Agnes. During the last 12 months, your SMX convention centers were not zero income. They weren't empty.
No, because
the spaces were being used.
Yeah, early on in the piece, we had to put on our thinking caps and say, let's remodel, reimagine, change the business dynamics. So we are able to get events that are permitted by the LGU and by DOH. And those are those events that we said. And we also used our facilities for ARC testing, you know, RT-PCR tests of companies. And we're getting ready also to be the venue for vaccination rollout program of some of the private companies that have decided to purchase vaccines for their own people.
So as I mentioned earlier, you have six so far SMX plus convention centers, plus one in Clark. So you've got in Manila, Aura, Davao, Bacolod, Megatrade Hall, and in Cebu. When these conventions, the big ones, the expos, actually come back, how will they look like post-COVID? I know that you have a, you know, hashtag SMX safe spaces. What's it going to look like? And more importantly, what's it going to cost? Are we talking about sanitized pods for one-on-one meetings, plexiglass barriers everywhere you look, contact tracing tokens for all persons going in and out, designated groups with specific time slots? I mean, could you walk us through what that experience will be like when these expos actually happen again?
We have been busy, Michelle, preparing for this time. And over the last few months, we've invested on hardware for health hygiene protocol. So thermal scanners, alcohol dispensers, ventilation system with fresh air intake regularly, PPEs, you know, frequent disinfecting of areas, signages, directional signages, audiovisual presentations that continuously remind people of protocols, even public address systems that is also reminding people to maintain the distance. We have, you might recall, escalators in a lot of escalators in SMX. We make sure that there's distancing between spaces, protocol marshals for proper crowd management. We also have CCTV cameras that can do facial recognition function. So that's very helpful also. And we have ambulance on standby. Buffets will be managed and not self-served later on in the piece, because that's still not allowed as yet. There will be a lot of crowd management and counting of people that go into through your doors. So queues will be managed properly. And of course, reduced capacities, because a space that used to take 1,000 can now only take maybe 300 to 500 at max.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, that's how it looks to us at this point.
And I know that there is a cap. The DOT accredited venues will be allowed 50% occupancy. So if it's a venue for 1,000 before, it can only be for 500 moving
That's
forward.
Correct.
Will you even be able to break even at that volume?
We need to help each other. The industry is really aching. We decided that with this additional hardware that we put in, we will not put additional cost and pass it on to organizers. That's not the idea. And don't forget, we also invested on the hardware, meaning our people. We trained them suitably and accurately to mitigate the further spread of the virus over the last few months.
Uh-huh.
Those are all things that we put in place, and we shouldn't, there's a supply and demand, right, Michelle?
Mm-hmm.
I think it is just morally wrong to be charging so much more at a time when every industry, and most industries, especially the meetings and business events industry, is aching. So it will probably take longer to break even. Before, we were enjoying very good business, but we realized that it may not happen overnight. So we will factor that into our forecast, of course, and make sure that we mitigate the losses to the organization too.
Okay. And do you think, you know, when you look forward, when you look ahead to the vaccination rollout, do you think it will all boil down to, you know, having quarantine bubble hotels like in Singapore, or a COVID passport where only those vaccinated will be allowed to move around your halls or to even enter for MICE and travel?
Yeah, I see that happening, and whatever it takes to control it, let's do it. My co-board members of PASEOS, Philippine Association of Convention Exhibition organizers and suppliers, mm-hmm. are just very excited to get back to it right away, observing all the safety protocols every single step of the way.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So I'm very curious, Agnes, how much of your MICE participants are foreigners, foreign nationals? Because I imagine a lot of MICE will also be dependent on travel and how quickly that jump starts.
Mm-hmm. Maybe when you talk of business events like trade shows, mm-hmm. a good 30 to 40% are foreign components, basically regional, a lot mm-hmm. of Asian component. But I foresee that not to travel yet. They will be the online part of a hybrid mm-hmm. event. And then the offline ones will be your domestic market. Mm-hmm. I think that's how it will start until it evolves fully to face again when quarantine days are no longer required for travelers.
And Agnes, final question. I guess let's take a step back and do the big picture. How critical do you think is it to restart MICE already, to have you guys back up and running? I mean, in your experience, how many employees are counting on this segment of the business? And after 1 year of having, you know, scaled down events, I imagine you were also forced to make some very painful decisions along the way.
Absolutely. MICE industry, we wear two hats. Sometimes we are a trade and industry mm-hmm. Related business, but really we are tourism related, and we know how tourism has been affected by this pandemic. So with it went some jobs. That's the reality mm-hmm. of the situation. Furlough has been in the picture, and some of them pivoted, but some were not able to pivot into other mm-hmm. revenue and income for their households. So it is very critical that we restart as soon as possible, because these business events directly impact the economy. These are events that talk about power or traffic situation mm-hmm. or, you know, cars, transport system. We feel the pulse of the economy in our halls and function rooms. So when there is nothing happening in them, we feel the economy has actually really been hurt
mm-hmm,
significantly.
Mm-hmm. And we are going to be rooting for this industry good luck in your endeavors. We're looking forward to welcoming, you know, more tourists, of course, and participants for these expos. Thank you so much for the insights and for joining us this morning, Agnes. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for having me, Michelle.
In other news, the Philippines logged 2,269 new coronavirus cases on Thursday, the second highest single day tally this year. This brings the country's total number of infections to more than 568,000. The death toll also jumped to over 12,200 with 72 new fatalities. 738 more patients recovered from the disease, bringing the number of active cases to over 32,000. Three laboratories failed to submit their data on time. Worldwide, more than 2.5 million people have died due to COVID-19. The U.S. has the highest death toll with nearly 508,000. Close to 113 million have been infected since the virus first emerged in Wuhan, China. Fewer than a quarter of Filipino adults are willing to receive a vaccine against COVID-19. This high level of vaccine hesitancy was revealed in a recent survey by the Okta Research Group. Only 19% of the 1,200 adults surveyed were open to receiving an anti-COVID-19 shot. 46% were unwilling, even if they were offered a safe and effective vaccine, while around 35% were undecided. The same survey also showed most Filipinos trust American-made vaccines, while only 13% prefer vaccines made in China. Military personnel serving on the front lines of the pandemic will be required to get Sinovac vaccine against COVID-19. The national government, meanwhile, rejects the request of vaccine makers to waive their liability for any adverse effects of their drugs. We have more from Joyce Balancho.
Vaccine manufacturers are requesting the Philippine government that they be spared of all possible liabilities relating to potential adverse effects of COVID-19 vaccine once it is given to Filipinos. Vaccine Czar Secretary Carlito Gavis Jr. said the government did not agree to this request of blanket immunity, prolonging the process of negotiations with suppliers. He explained that while government is preparing the indemnity fund, manufacturers should ensure their vaccines are indeed effective and safe to use. Senate Minority Leader Franklin Drilon backs Galvez, stressing that granting blanket immunity is against the law and contrary to public policy. Galvez said around 161 million doses of vaccines are expected to arrive this year, but he admitted that only 5.1 million doses will be delivered in the first quarter. This covers supplies coming from the World Health Organization's COVAX facility, donations from China, and some jabs to be procured by the Department of Health. A total of 24 million doses will arrive by the second quarter, while bulk of deliveries will arrive on the third or fourth quarter of the year. For AstraZeneca, Galvez said they have secured a supply agreement while advance payments have been made by private companies and some local government units for the purchase of around 17 million doses. Galvez adds, the Philippines is still finalizing the supply agreement in terms of delivery for Moderna's jab. He hopes to convince suppliers to deliver vaccines at an earlier date, even if there's an added cost to the government.
Nagre-negotiate din po tayo kahit mapamahal ng konti, basta ma-early delivery lang po sila ng second quarter at saka po ng first quarter. Yun po ang ginagawa po natin, tinik-teknik, ino-offset po natin ng prices na ano, yung kanilang price. Dadagdagan po yung prices para mapaaga po.
Secretary Galvez said he is willing to receive Sinovac shot. Health Secretary Francisco Duque also underscores the importance of getting vaccinated.
Marami pong mga mayor, katulad po ni Yorme, at saka kami po, magbabolunteer po kami na talagang to have yung building na confidence, magpapakuna po kami. Dahil kasi po talagang ano namin, ang natin, safe naman po yung Sinovac. Dahil sa rollout po ng Turkey at saka Indonesia, ang priority po talaga healthcare workers, yung age 18 to 59.
Pfizer, Moderna, AstraZeneca, and Sinovac, based on their clinical trial data, 100% ang efficacy rate nila in preventing severe COVID infection. Ayun naman, sir, ang importante kasi yung namamatay galing dun sa severe. So if you're able to prevent severe infection, walang mamatay. And Sinovac belongs to that group that offers or provides 100% efficacy or effectiveness, sir.
Of the 600,000 Sinovac doses donated by China, about 100,000 will go to the Department of National Defense. AFP spokesman Major General Edgar Arevalo says military personnel serving on the COVID-19 front lines are required to get inoculated with a Sinovac vaccine. Joyce Balancho, ABS-CBN News.
Up next, the Philippine Stock Exchange resumes trading following Thursday's holiday. We check in on the opening numbers with Ron Acoba of Trading Edge. Market Edge, we'll be right back.
Have to be a working manager and a leader at the same time. Your team will only do as you do and not as you say. So it's very important to set the right example.
People who are in the leadership sector should be able to walk the talk. You cannot preach about sustainability without making sacrifices, small sacrifices in your lifestyle. That's the key. It will redound to the individual behavior of the people preaching and of the people actually following.
Authentic community. By focusing on that particular core value, a lot of these Gen Zs and millennials can be themselves. They don't have to pretend anymore. As we prioritize the voices and the feedback of our young,
You have to be a working manager and a leader at the same time.
You're still watching Market Edge. The headlines: Wall Street suffers its worst day in weeks, with the Nasdaq posting its largest daily percentage fall in 4 months. Tech stocks under pressure amid rising bond yields. Asian markets mirroring those steep losses. Here at home, the PSEI resumes trading, kicking off at the 6,700 level, joining the Asian-wide bloodbath, now back to the 6,600 level. We speak with Ron Acoba of Trading Edge for a market outlook. And COVID-19 cases in the Philippines hit 586,000. Worldwide, confirmed infections near 113 million. The Philippine Stock Exchange right now down by nearly 1%. That's 64 points. We're now at 66.91, the number to beat to be able to snap a two-week losing streak. But it seems like it's going to be very hard to beat this. 69.26. We're about 250 points away from that. Joining us now for his take on the markets, Ron Acoba of Trading Edge Consultancy. Good morning, Ron. Thanks for joining us.
Good morning, Mimi. Thanks for having me.
It's not a very good morning for the market, huh? I mean, I imagine if you're a long investor, this is the time when you close your eyes and just, you know, wake up when this is all over. How does this market feel to you, Ron? Does it feel heavy?
Well, it certainly feels heavy, but nothing that we did not expect, at least from the way the Trading Edge saw it. If you remember the last time I was here, we noted that the index was actually very due for a pullback and then consolidate thereafter after it hit an 11 month high of around 7.3. Couple of reasons why. From a technical point of view, this is just a little recap. From a technical point of view, the 7,300 level was a major resistance, still is at this point. Why? Because it acted as a 7-year support in the past. So it will take a little more than a couple of weeks of attempts for the index to really go through it.
Mm-hmm.
On the fundamental end, at 7.3, the index was at 22 times. The index was also at a premium relative to its 2021 consensus target of 7.240 at that time. Short of saying that, you know, at 7,000, 7.2, 7.3, the index was expected and was due for a pullback. Now that we're here at 6.7, 6.6, with the U.S. dropping, with the S&P 500, the index dropping 2.5%, it's pretty clear that the region and the Philippines will likely follow suit. And in fact, we've actually got lower. And you mentioned the culprit is rising bond yields with the U.S. 10-year bonds rising to around 1.55%. From just 1.34 a couple of days back, mm-hmm. and from 0.92 in January. So that's a major increase in 10-year yields. On our end in the Philippines, market yields, 10-year bond yields, also rose to about 3.7% from just 3% in January. So as you know, 10-year market bond yields are used as a proxy to discount and calculate for fair values, which means that higher interest rates or higher market rates, specifically 10-year yields, would essentially lead to lower fair value estimates. And I guess that's what the market is pricing in right now.
But I get that we were due for a pullback and here we are at 6,700. Are you expecting any more capitulation? I mean, how low can we go?
Well, the thing is, if market yields continue to rise, then certainly we'll see more movements away from risk asset. Because as mentioned, anytime we see an further increases in market yields, then that would just essentially lead to lower company valuations. As to how lower can we go, in terms of chart wise. The nearest support that I see is around 6.5. We're a couple of points away from that. Okay. We'll see if that particular level will be able to hold through.
And, you know, for the past few weeks, months, in fact, it's been the locals supporting this market. The foreigners have been selling us out. Seventh straight consecutive selling for the PSEI, for foreign funds. You've got MSCI rebalancing, I understand, taking effect at the close of day today. The FTSE by mid-March. Are we expecting any more rotations away from the Philippine market?
Looking at, for example, flow adjustments from from MSCI or FTSE related changes is a wrong way of looking at it, because these indices are supposed to just mirror and reflect the actual basket. So unless, of course, there's a change in the way that an index is measured, much like 2 years ago when the MSCI decided to increase the weighting of China shares by fourfold, thereby resulting to a decrease in the weightings of other components like the Philippines. Without such changes, then it's actually just self-reflective. Mm-hmm. What is actually happening, Mimi, is that global funds are flowing into markets that offer faster than expected recovery. Markets like China, markets like at least before the recent rata, markets like China, markets like Vietnam, Thailand, Malaysia, and even to some degree in Indonesia. Interestingly, because I recently just saw this in a recent study, is that these countries are expected to vaccinate 60% of their population by 2022, by next year. The Philippines, on the other, sad to say, the Philippines, on the other hand, are expected to vaccinate 60% of its population not by next year, but as soon as late 2023 or even 2024, which means that delayed recovery in terms of economy, in terms of corporate earnings. And I guess that's one of the main factors why foreigners are flocking to countries like China, Vietnam, which if you take note, most actually revisited their highs, at least in the past week, their all-time highs in the past week. However, the Philippines is still stuck 25 to 30% below its peak. So I think that's one of the major reasons, aside, of course, from a systematic increase in interest rates, why we're seeing foreigners flee the country.
If that study is indeed correct, then should we expect that foreigners will keep selling us until 2023? Or 2024?
Markets, as you noted previously, are forward-looking. Mm-hmm. So I wouldn't say it would take that long. Perhaps this year.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And going ahead, perhaps this year, or at least for the most part of this year.
Okay,
but look. Maybe come 2022, assuming late 2023, will come a step or two in the direction of a recovery in terms of vaccinations. Then I think foreigners would start to step in and position ahead of that particular recovery.
Okay, you made me sweat right there when I heard your interesting factoid. How about this one? Something closer. Next week, when you look at the calendar, it's pretty quiet. We're getting market PMI numbers to start the week, capped by February inflation print on Friday. Are you expecting the inflation number to move the needle as we enter March?
Well, certainly that's what the market appears to be pricing in. As I've noted, the 10-year yields, even one-year bond yields have already picked up, with the Philippine 10-year government bond yield rising by more than 20% in the last couple of weeks. So certainly market is pricing in an increase in inflation. We actually saw that in January, where inflation already picked up to a 2-year high of 4.2%. So with market rates continuing to go up, perhaps we'll see an even higher increase in the basket of prices, goods and services for the previous month.
Okay, let's now go over some interesting corporate stories that we have from this morning. Let's start with Philex Mining posting 2020 net income of $1.2 billion. That's good news because they're coming from a net loss of $648 million in 2019. Revenue also up 15%. The company is citing favorable metal prices for gold and copper, and production also sustaining the increasing momentum there. Philex Mining shares, How do you feel about them? For Philex Mining
specifically, as what the company noted, mm-hmm. Gold prices for 2020 actually rose by about 25.6% from around $1,500 per ounce December ending 2019 to about $1,900
per ounce
ending 2020. Mm-hmm. Yes, per ounce. So that's a notable increase in the price of what they are producing. Of course, whenever you have an increase in metal prices, all the more they would want to hasten up their production, which mm-hmm. actually is what they did. So a combination of an increase in metal prices and to mm-hmm. some degree production led to a turnaround in their bottom line. However, the way that I see it, for the past few months at least, the price of the yellow metal appears to be peaking or have peaked already and may once again enter into a new down leg. If that happens, then another turnaround to the opposite direction would happen, at least from Philex's point of view.
Just to add, Philex Mining also says they're aiming to begin operations at Silangan project soon, adding that it's working to sign up a strategic partner to make that happen. But for now, they're going to be optimizing the life of the Padcal mine. How about this one? BPI board okays the increase in authorized capital stock from $49.6 billion to $50.6 billion. This is, of course, related to the merger of BPI Family Savings Bank to BPI, the parent. And BDO also posting a 36% drop in full-year net income for 2020 to $28.2 billion as it increased provisions for loan losses fivefold. Times five to $30.2 billion. It ended the year with non-performing loans ratio at 2.65%. Is it time to get into BDO stocks or not yet?
Well, personally, I'd say yes. While the stock is currently weak and not really trending in any fashion, assuming that we enter a new phase of this bull market, for example, then BDO, the likes of BDO, BPI, and Matt Frank would certainly be at the mm-hmm. forefront. And expectedly, you mentioned a decrease in the profit of earnings of BDO for 2020 because of an increase in loan provision. That actually is not isolated to BDO. That is also the same with mm-hmm. with its peers, BPI, Metrobank, and to some degree to the other second tier banks. What was cushioning its earnings was, at least to some degree, the increase in trading profits. Without the trading profits that they realized in the past year, then you would see an even deeper mm-hmm. deeper contraction in its bottom line. But moving forward, at least for 2021, at least for the first half of the present year, I expect the performance of banks to continue to be weak, precisely because of delayed recovery, especially with, for example, with GCQ being extended by mm-hmm. at least another month. Then you would expect loan provisions to continue to be high mm-hmm. because consumers would have little power to pay back, given that there's very little business to do. So. Mm-hmm. Having said that, assuming we get over that hump, then that would be the point to position back in the financial, in the banking space.
Okay, so that's for the banking. How about this? There's a Bloomberg report that Aboitiz Equity Ventures is considering the sale of a minority stake, anywhere between 20% and 30%, of its animal feeds business, Pilmico. This deal is expected to value the firm at $1 billion. Do you think this is a good move? What sort of indication or messaging does this send to investors?
I think what's prompting the company to at least consider selling a minority take in Filmico is the fact that while their international business have actually increased by 22% to 340 something million, at least in the 9 month ending 2020, with a full operations of gold coin management, mm-hmm. is that their local unit is suffering a decrease in margins because of low in selling prices. So that's actually one of the reasons why I think the company is considering a sale, because of a very difficult market environment, at least mm-hmm. at least in 2020.
Okay. Ron, we don't have much time, so very quickly, let's do your blind item. Talk to us about the stock that you're monitoring closely. Don't tell us what, just describe.
So. I believe, I'm not seeing it right now, but I believe the stock is down, I think, 5% as we speak. But one of the reasons why I'm at least intrigued in this particular stock is that it's actually in the mining space. It's a leader, or the biggest nickel producing local miner. Why am I intrigued? It's because of the fact that the global prices of nickel, at least as of yesterday, have reached their 12-year high on the back of course the ban of Indonesian exports, mm-hmm. expected global recovery, and then number three. Expected higher demand from EV sales, which uses batteries that uses more mm-hmm. more nickel. So having said that, if you know the global prices of nickel continues to go up, then that would surely spill over in the share prices of nickel miners. Mm-hmm. And at least as of the past couple of weeks, that has been the case. Of course, it's a different story when that general market is correcting, much like how we're seeing it right now.
One final question. How much upside are you seeing for the share price of this stock?
At least if it stabilizes, and like I said, assuming nickel prices mm-hmm. continue to go up, at least about 20% from its present level.
Okay, 20%. We're just going to have to guess which stock you were talking about to ride that 20% upside. Ron, always a pleasure to speak with you. Thank you so much for joining us. Have a great weekend.
Thank you.
Time to zip through the top headlines from major business papers. From Business World, the Philippine Finance Department says imports of COVID-19 vaccines will be exempted from taxes and duties. Finance Secretary Sonny Dominguez says the importation will be included in the department's Express Lane or Mabuhay Lane, where tax and duty exception applications will be processed within 24 hours. From Business Mirror, Philippine transactions with the rest of the world yielded a dollar deficit in January as the national government withdrew foreign currency from Philippine Central Bank reserves to pay for its international debt obligations, and this trade recorded a deficit at the start of the year. And from the Wall Street Journal, ByteDance agrees to pay $92 million to settle a class action suit alleging it illegally collected some data of teenage TikTok users. The ABS-CBN News Channel is inviting everyone to ANCX, Wine, Cheese, and Everything in Between, a digital event moderated by our very own David Sildran. Elevate your appreciation of food and wine as our experts guide you on how to pair quality wines with some of your favorite dishes. Join the live stream on February 27th, 6 p.m. Tickets are now available at ktx.ph. And for those who tried to guess the blind item from Ron Acoba, this is a stock that intrigues him, which he sees a 20% at least upside for the share price. He says it's in the mining industry, a leader, and it's set to benefit from, of course, higher demand from EV vehicles, Indonesia's export ban, and just generally the global recovery. It's also benefiting from the global price of, from the fact that global price of nickel has reached 12-year highs. This stock is Nickel Asia, the largest nickel producer here in the Philippines. And that is it for Market Edge. I'm Michelle Long. Thank you for watching. Stay safe. You can watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of our shows online. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. For feedback, you can email us at ancfeedback@abs-cbn.com. Keep it here on ANC.
It's a long road to peace in Mindanao, one that is beset with